to the WUDuP Vodcast, the one that's actually number 10.
Actually number
because
10.
Because last week we made a really big deal about it being number 10. It was number 9. So we're actually right this time. Okay. But we're comm majors, we don't do math, it's okay. I'm your host, David. Joining me today is Andy.
You guys must have been really, really thin, if you ask me.
Yes. And Brendan and Patric.
I feel honored to be a part of the 10th episode.
Is like, this your first one, too?
First one.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm as lost as you are.
Wow.
I mean, we... Right before we started, you guys were wondering where the microphone was.
True.
Yeah. Hangs from the ceiling above us.
So what do you guys talk about on the podcast?
Literally whatever you want.
Is it possible to have two conversations going at once? Like,
not really.
If Andy and
is
I
it possible?
About, like,
yes.
Football,
like, this is the first time
is,
I've got
is
classes
it ideal?
On, when I'm on TV in the studio and you guys talk about, like, something else.
Like editing or something?
Yeah.
You guys both like editing?
No.
I mean, technically, we could talk about whatever we wanted. You guys could talk about whatever you wanted. That wouldn't make for good content. There's no way to, like, separate the audio there.
Do you have a plan of attack for today's episode?
Not even slightly. The only thing I know that's gone on is the Destiny 2 trailer
came out today.
Looks like we're having a separate
That's exactly, like, I'm sitting here trying to think of something.
Didn't play Destiny 1, so... Yeah.
I didn't even know there was a game called Destiny.
Mm, well, now you know.
Unless you're mispronouncing Madden. But that seems like...
Oh, yeah, same game. Same company.
Same thing. Then we can
I love about. That game.
Yeah.
For the new one. In that case.
I'll tell you what, I haven't played Madden in years.
Really?
Yes.
I've played way too much Madden in my life.
Looks like it, man.
Yeah. Really, that's the truth.
I mean, I'm kind of scruffy too, but kind of... I looked at myself in the mirror today and I was like, you look disgusting.
Do I have visible facial hair right
yep,
now?
Yep,
yes.
You do. And I do too. And that's how I know I'm actually becoming a man. I'm only missing, like, the spot right here where no facial hair grows yet.
You know how long it's been? Where I couldn't.
This yeah, same. I would always just shave to think, make people think that I just shave all the time. But the truth was, is that I would have such bad spots of hair that it was just embarrassing. I still do. It's terrible, but I'm getting there. Next
I know,
couple
I
years.
Have eyes. Yeah.
Wow. You got
yeah.
four eyes.
I shave in anticipation of being on the show, so I can't say much.
Mm.
I try to look good. But I mean, I have to do everything I can, because this is...
At least you have, like, a real goatee.
Yeah.
Yeah,
you look good.
I
look like a pirate.
I've had this since end of sophomore year now.
I can see that. You got the whole thing going now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I like it.
I even have pirate colors on. But it's not a pirate
hat.
It's a Detroit Tigers hat.
Yeah.
Interesting.
So how are you guys doing? Tell us a little bit about yourselves.
Okay, well, I guess I'm Brendan Keeney. I'm a senior, so let's go. We're graduating in, what, 30 days? Or
something like that.
Something great.
31.
31 days.
Yes.
I don't know what I'm doing yet or where I'm going to do it.
Just love being asked about that.
Isn't it?
Constantly.
By everyone. It's amazing.
I know one person that's a senior in our department that has a job right now.
Who?
Nat. She's the... communications director at for the Washington Wild Things.
Well, congratulations to them.
Yeah, very cool. She's very good at what she does. So.
Mm-hmm. That's it. That's all I know.
Well, I'm still looking for jobs. I don't know. I'm looking predominantly in Pittsburgh and Buffalo, and hopefully on the side of sports, but I will take anything at this point. So
and hopefully a future employer is watching this right now.
Actually,
saying,
that's the guy.
Brendan Keeney.
Yep.
Remind me after the show, there's a station in Steubenville looking for reporters.
Steubenville?
Yeah.
Right.
That's not far.
So. Cool. Let's go. Looks like I'm filling out more applications and cover letters. So.
That's always a good time. Anything else going on?
No, but I do have a question for you guys who are also in the application process.
Mm-hmm.
Are cover letters not the worst? Like having to like...
No,
really
no.
One from
no. Cover letters are not the worst.
I'm just saying like the creation of them like
the
for
worst?
Every job.
Well, see, I have like a general template. That
same, I do too.
But the worst is when you apply to a job and you upload a resume, it takes your resume, fills in a
its
work
thing.
History,
yeah.
employment
yep.
thing,
yeah.
and throws your resume away.
I agree.
That's
like,
terrible.
There's a specific way I had this mapped out.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
I went to an interview, brought a copy of my resume, said, oh, this is nice. This is much better than what we get to see. Like, what they see looks like crap.
Right.
And it's their own system that makes you do that. It's not just, like, upload a resume.
Right. It's so weird.
Mm-hmm.
We have all the seniors, and then I'm still here for 3 more years.
Mm.
You'll get there.
Freshman.
You'll get there.
Yeah.
What are you up to?
Andy? What am I up to? Jeez. It's a lot slower now that football and basketball is over.
Agreed.
Here on campus. And so it's just like, look at all this time and space. And
must be nice.
lots of portfolio stuff. I'm uploading videos as we speak. Have my own website at least now.
There you go.
Something I couldn't say.
Weebly?
A while ago. Yeah.
Weebly's really good.
I got Weebly too.
And I'm looking at everyone else's and it's like, all right, what can I do? And you know what's really nice or really cool about the department? It's how, like, everyone, even though they have similar majors, they're, like, different flavors.
Mm-hmm.
Like, everyone where they invested in, Pat, you'll see this over your 4 years about how everyone invests their time differently. And it's not like someone put in a lot more time than someone else, but lots of people puts in lots of time. But, like, you did Yellow Jacket, sports announcing, Chatham hockey.
Right.
I did, like, you know, radio announcing for MSA. I did JSW like every week for 4 years, and then I did some audio stuff for the PAC. And like, we're in the same major, and we have similar skill sets, but we're still like very different.
Right.
And so it's fun to really look back now on 4 years and see how, like, where everyone ended up and like what they chose to do. And
like, even people that, like, to go off that point, like people who are very similar, like I feel like people group you and Dawson together,
mm-hmm.
but even he was more on like
He's
the technical side of,
tech.
Yeah, on the print side of things, whereas you were, you know, more on the TV, radio, like on
mm-hmm.
air all the time kind
and
of.
And like we both are involved in JSW for like years, or involved with Woosin pregame halftime
right.
for years, but he's been producing the show and I've been on the show.
Right.
And it is funny how people are like grouped together.
Yeah.
Just in the minds of everyone, because that is definitely a thing. But it's fun. It's going to be sad not being around everyone
Absolutely.
Anymore.
Yeah, I've
definitely
been,
missed the people.
Mm-hmm.
I've been in a leadership position in the newscast since the second semester of my freshman year.
There you go.
And there was like legitimate concern going into this year, like who can take it over?
Yeah.
Like
everyone's got their
else.
Like everyone. You got to
yeah.
find your niche to make a name for yourself in the department, I feel
yep.
like. And so, like, you can't have a ton of people occupying the same niche, or else it's not really a niche anymore. I guess
mm-hmm.
that's the definition, so.
And we have the dynamic, at least at the TV station, has changed a lot with what students do to get involved.
Mm-hmm.
Because, like, the newscast, we have so many student-produced packages for the newscast now. Like, 4 years ago?
None. Right.
None at all.
I remember that, yeah.
And the dynamic has just changed. Like, we actually have freshmen don't come in planning to sit in an anchor desk for the newscast and being the main anchor as soon as they get here anymore. Like, you have to earn being
right.
up there.
That's what I was.
And you
I was
do that
anchor.
By going to shoot packages.
Yeah, I was the anchor first semester.
Exactly.
Of freshman year.
Yeah, and that I've changed that. Like, if you're that good, you'll be up there. But if you're not, you're gonna go shoot packages until you are good enough to be up there.
Yeah.
Like,
have you found that's dissuaded people from joining the newscast?
I found that it's dissuaded people who were here during like your time, where it was just you get up there and you're on. But now that we have new people coming in and we're telling them that's how
know.
It is,
yeah.
it's all they know and it's
yeah.
what they do.
That's
and it's great. I mean, it's something we had to do to be better. And I think that in the long run, it's going to benefit students a lot more than, like, it doesn't take too much skill to read a teleprompter.
Right.
But having all those news values and
the technical
new skills
side of things too.
To make a package, like
yeah.
report something. Like, even for sports guys, like, if, you know, J.D. Lydic is a good example. He graduated last year. He worked as a news reporter for how long? I think he's the sports guy there now,
mm-hmm.
but he got into that by being in news.
Right.
And like, if you plan on being a sports guy at a news station, you can't do that unless you can do news.
Right.
So
it gets your foot in the door for sure.
Yeah.
Well, I think that's another thing. You're talking about the progression of the extracurriculars we have in the department. I think it's interesting to see how things improve and are changed over time.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like, when we were, what, sophomores when Plead Your Case started?
Yeah, and actually, we were freshmen.
Were we freshmen?
We were.
That's right. And so the progression of that show and just how, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
How the formats changed.
Yeah, things were really different. Like, significantly different. And,
yeah.
Like, a lot of the projects that I took over, and I'm not, like, a leadership position person, or I haven't had that in, you know, the newspaper, TV station, radio station. But, like, the projects I have taken over, like the PAC Football Focus, Into the Swarm, they were practicum projects of students that came
yeah.
before me. And so I really appreciated those people starting it and being like, hey, can you help me? And then, like Dave was saying, who's going to take this over? I was right there like, I'm going to take this over. And they're
mm-hmm.
like, you should probably do that. So, and that's been a lot of fun.
Even
right.
JSW changed throughout this year alone. I mean, we used to have like people come and talk about the sports on the show. Now we have like packages about it and graphics for like the stats of the players.
Yep.
Yeah, that is pretty neat. And JSW, the way that it's changed, they've made it, and so like a lot of the freshmen are those analysts, and so it's like bite-sized TV time, where like when I was a freshman, if you were on JSW, like I was on JSW as a freshman, you were on for like the whole show. It's you and the other person talking the whole time. And it's really nice because it's easier preparation. You just have to do one sport. You're just there for 2.5 minutes, and we pepper you with questions you already know, and it's a nice chance for the freshmen. And they have gotten way better as the year goes on, so it's a nice little starter show. And I always think it's funny where people like get upset or they're like, man, I think I could have done better. Like my first JSW, I literally did not look at a camera. Like I didn't look at a camera. I think Dave, you were my stage manager and you were like, I don't think you looked at a camera. And I was like, I didn't look at a camera.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, 4 years later, like you do it every week. And it gets to be where it's just like, yeah, here's the camera.
Yeah.
It's, man.
Have you found that ad-libbing is much easier now?
I have.
Right?
Like, I just started being on a lot of stuff, like, this year mostly. Like, last year I started the mosh pit, and, you know, that was an hour for a semester every week of just talking, then 2 hours every week,
yeah.
And then I was doing the morning buzz for a while, too. And now this semester, you know, I do this every single week. I'm the only person that hasn't missed a show so far for the vodcast. We've done, like, over 20 now. I've been on the newscast. I've hosted a game show. I hosted the green room. Like, we still do the mosh pit 2 hours a week.
You do buzz 2 hours every Friday?
Oh, not anymore. I got rid of that. I wasn't doing it alone.
That's
not the person that was with me.
Friday. Oh my goodness.
Yeah. And just how much more comfortable I am just talking.
Yeah.
Is amazing.
I'll look back at things. And, like, you don't realize what you said as you're saying them. And then I look back at, like, my highlights, and I'm like, how did I think of that at the time?
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's
good or bad.
Yes.
Where it's, like,
yes.
How that was done.
Yes. The early stuff more bad, and the later stuff more good. But, I mean, it's just weird, the progression that you don't even realize is happening, you know?
And I think it's nice to have that crossover. Like, even for radio for TV guys and radio for newspaper guys, just for talking, like, on air, that'll help you when you're TV talking on air.
Yeah.
And I know Jake, who's a newspaper guy.
Yeah.
He's on Into the Swarm, like, with us, and we're always interviewing athletes. And he's like, man, talking on air really helps me in terms of asking questions, like, when I'm at games or as
yeah.
a reporter, instead of just, like, talk about whatever. So I think it is really nice that we've been able to cross over and do a whole bunch of different things.
Yeah, I mean, it's really... If you want to get good at it, just do it. Like, I honestly, Patrick's another perfect example.
I'm a shy person. I
started
the mosh pit, and I
yeah.
just stop talking. I've started more conversations on here. I now do the playlist every week for the mosh pit,
yeah.
And like technically host, but he's still the host because he's... Because
I'm in charge.
He's in charge, but still, I mean, I
yeah.
sit there and I start conversations and everything.
But you hosting the mosh pit, your first show... versus you hosting the mosh pit this week, huge exponential difference in just how well you present yourself and speak. And it's been like, what, 3-4 weeks?
Yeah.
No,
yeah.
It's been 3-4 weeks, maybe 5. I think I have like 5 playlists on my computer because I haven't created this week yet.
Yeah.
Very cool.
And at least you have someone to go to. I'm here with the hip-hop show and it's just like...
Yeah, well...
What's going to happen?
I, you know, the plan was for Schinkel to take over, and Schinkel wanted someone to be with him when I leave, so we brought in him, and he's more taking over than Schinkel does. So,
nice.
Schinkel sits there and writes his yellow jacket papers while we're on air. good.
Yeah, Mondays and Tuesdays can be crazy.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
It's hectic in this department, but I'll tell you what, we're doing, at least in my opinion, a better job of not letting people spread themselves out too much. And I'd rather have someone with minor roles in a lot and one major role than four major roles. Because those people with four major roles just end up like slacking, not being able to do everything.
Well, that was Craig Milko's big thing. You got to be a jack of all trades in some capacity, but you also want to be a master of one.
Yeah.
So that you're not only, you know, you don't just know a little bit of each thing, because that's not really a hireable trait, just because you're somewhat versatile. But if you're not, you know, if you can't offer something really good in one specific area, I think that hinders your higher, your
mm-hmm.
what you can bring to
it. I was thinking about this today, like for my website. What do you write on that first screen, like your home screen, where you want to highlight something about yourself? And then it's like, you can do this, 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 and this. And then it's like, what do I want to put there?
I think I just say media in general, and I hope that media just encompasses everything that comes along with it, whether it be
newspaper,
camera work, talking
mm-hmm.
on camera in any capacity, shooting packages and whatnot. I hope that like sports media and communications kind of encompasses all that, and that's what employers take away from my homepage. Here's my thing, is like, to me, what I most care about is the demo reel stuff. Like, okay, great. If they read my bio, that's great. Like, I'm not too concerned about the bio. At least I hope I shouldn't be too concerned about the bio. And, like, look at what I have for journalism, look what I have for radio and television, actual material, you know.
What football games did you have this year?
I had TV.
Yeah.
I had Muskingum and Geneva.
Oh, man.
Two really good games.
Yeah.
So that helped me out a lot.
That was me last year, where I had Teal and Grove City, and going into those games, I was like, oh, these are bad teams. Like, going into the year,
great,
I was
games.
Like, darn it. And both turned out to be really, really solid games. And then this year, I had the marquee games, Case and Jay.
And Jay, yeah.
Not great games.
at least Jay was close.
At least Jay was close, but it was low scoring and ugly.
Yep, true. Well, I mean, to be fair, though, the Geneva game was as ugly as it gets. I mean, how many turnovers? There were like seven turnovers between the two teams.
Three picks from Waynesburg in
yeah.
his first three
possessions. A fumble on the 1 yard line
mm-hmm.
that turned out to be a safety.
Mm-hmm.
Or not a safety, a touchback. So it's like sometimes it's the ugly ones that can
safety.
Give you some of the highlights, too. But I understand what you're saying. Yours was, the J game was more like incomplete pass. You know, run up the middle for 2 yards, stop, punt, you know, stuff like so. I don't know.
Yeah, thank goodness for Grove City last year and Kevin Barnes.
Yeah.
That's all I'm saying.
Kevin Barnes. Yeah. I was talking about this with Austin, who's predominantly been my partner in both radio and TV throughout the 4 years here. And so there was a stretch of like three games where he would pick the wrong half every time.
That's me. Yep. That is literally
So the first time we had the call of one of the Bethany games. It was the home Bethany game for TV, and Bethany like was running away with the game in the opening half. So I think it was like a 15-point lead going into the second half, and then Waynesburg came back, or it was either Bethany or Westminster, and in my half, Waynesburg came back and took the lead, and then ended up losing close. And then the next game, he was like, "No, I want the second half, just so that it's good." And then I ended up having like really close, good first half. And then the other team just ran away with it.
Do you just say, oh, I'll do this?
We kind of just take turns. So, like, I'll take the first. And
I've lost, like, the last three straight coin flips.
See, that's why I can't do coin flips, man. You have an unlucky person like you, and then Dawson gets
tails,
all the
tails.
Dawson gets all the publicity for it, you know?
Yeah, well, at least he called W&J's game winner against us in men's basketball. And it was like,
yeah.
Never wanted to call that or see that.
Yeah.
But just sort of a tough year overall.
Overall, yeah.
What would you guys actually say is the difference between like announcing football, where you have like the break in between each play, and announcing basketball, where it's all fast paced?
To be honest, I am much better at announcing the fast paced games. So like hockey and basketball, I would say, are my two best. And then I really, football's okay. I wouldn't by any stretch of the imagination consider myself to be a great football announcer. And I'm okay at football. And baseball, I really struggle with filling the time in between pitches and whatnot. And you know, for baseball, I just go to kind of my crutches, like giving the count all the time, and you know.
Well, repetition isn't a bad.
Repetition's
thing.
Not bad, especially at least for radio.
Radio.
It's not bad.
But how many was this your only year for TV football? Like, it's hard
yes.
to get into.
Yes. It, yeah.
That first time, so it was nice having another year.
Yep.
To do that, even though my games weren't very good.
Right.
But TV is a lot of fun, at least for me, because you don't have to be like in this. It's more of a chance to step back and.
So you like TV more?
I do really.
I actually like radio more.
No, they're both great.
What's your opinion on dead air during baseball?
TV or radio?
I'm gonna go with TV because radio there shouldn't be.
I hate dead air.
You do?
I do. I think there's a place for it. Like if on TV you can get away with it if there's an iconic play or something like that. But to me, just dead air in general means that you don't have enough preparation. And there are certain broadcasts in baseball where I will not watch because like dead air is kind of like a crutch for them. Yes.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking of. Like
Cleveland and Toronto are the two that come to mind when I
because
when I think of dead
Scott's
air broadcasts.
A big Cleveland Indians guy, so
yeah.
He's got the Cleveland game on all the time, and it'll be on TV, and I'll be laying on the couch, and it'll get real quiet for a while, and all of a sudden someone will talk, and I'll like jump, like, wait, the TV's still on? Like, you're still going?
Exactly.
Like,
that's exactly.
And we've gone
Cleveland
like a
is...
solid 2-3 pitches without speaking, like. What are you doing?
I don't like that. Like, I don't mind, I don't think you need to fill up the entire broadcast with topic. Like, that's egregious. Like, 2 or 3 pitches
if
not speaking.
If it is noticeable that all of a sudden he starts talking
right.
and I'm like, wait, there's still a game on?
Yeah.
It's a problem. Like, and I've talked to people about this, and the one guy was like, what do you mean? I love Cleveland. I don't want to hear all that crap, like, the whole time. Like, don't we talk when something's going on?
And,
like,
and of course, it's all a matter of opinion. I love Red Sox broadcasts, and because I'm a Red Sox fan, so disclaimer, you know, I'll naturally like them more. But like, they're hilarious. You know, like
yeah.
if I'm okay with them not describing the play because we can see the play, and especially for baseball, a foul ball is a foul ball. Like, you know,
yeah.
nothing too big there. But they'll tell stories, and they will. You know, just stuff like that to pass the time along, and I really love the humor that they inject into the broadcast.
Mm-hmm.
And so, like, the silence to me, it's like you could be using that time so much more effectively.
Yeah, I agree with that. I mean, I'm not an announcer, but I feel like, as far as TV goes, if anyone's watching, they can see what's going on, so you're not as much of a just saying the action and repeating what's happening because it's kind of
yeah.
like, what's the point? You are a form of entertainment at the same time and a form of extra, like, statistics and information. And I want to hear things.
Yeah.
I don't want to just...
What's your thought on silence?
Silence. I mean, extended silence like Dave probably would be a problem. But usually coming into a game, if I'm doing a TV game, it's Waynesburg. And I know so much about Waynesburg. I know, like, for football season, because I'm doing the football focus and everything. I know about the conference. I know about the team. I talk to coach all the time. So usually there's something to talk about. And then in basketball, if I'm not saying anything, Kyle will be saying something. And that's one thing we do really well as a duo is we work well with each other. And that's something I don't think of, like, at all. But there aren't a lot of awkward moments where, man, he should be talking right now, or I need to be saying something. We usually just fill in where necessary.
Right.
And I went through and was doing my basketball highlights the other day, and it's all right for there to be a little bit of a, like, if it's against the zone and they're passing on the outside, wait until someone gets inside the three-point arc and then you say their name or whatever.
Right.
But I don't have a problem with silence, as long as it's not something like Dave's taking a nap, he starts to drift away. And then it's like, and the 3-2.
Yeah.
Exactly.
It's like, I wasn't thinking about that.
It actually, like, shocked me how much dead air there was.
Yeah.
I mean, one pitch I'm fine with. Like, if it's like one pitch of dead air, you can sit there and watch the pitch and then they go back to talking, I'm fine with that. But,
and there are things to talk about. Like, I did a game with Lanny literally yesterday, and, like, the things that he talks about between pitches, like, there are so many just tiny things. With the teams, with the coaches, with baseball in general.
Right.
He could fill a broadcast of just, like, baseball in general talk. Or high school kid talk. Like, there's always something you could be saying.
Mm-hmm.
So, and especially with radio, there really isn't a place for it, because it's, you're driving this plane.
I mean, it's understandable when they have, like, a set team you play with, or you announce for the entire year, you have, like, stories about the team that you can just go on about. So, like what Kenny said with Boston, like, the Boston announcers, they're basically around the team the entire season. So you have stories to tell, like, about the players and, like, how they're doing and everything. And even, I think, there's also, like, tons of injury reports. I remember, like, even, like, the evolution of baseball. I mean, I remember people used to run straight into the catchers. Now it's kind of like, oh, there's a catcher there. What happened to plowing into the catcher?
That's actually a recent rule change.
Yeah.
Is it a rule change?
Yeah, the specifics are kind of hard. Basically, catchers aren't allowed to block the plate anymore.
Okay.
But the rule gets kind of like fuzzy and gray.
Okay.
But yeah, it's to protect them, but...
Yeah, because there have been a lot of like really
Buster Posey injury was pretty much what changed the rule. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So
I was scrolling through Facebook and I seen the highlight of just people plowing into the catchers. Like, that's when baseball was fun to watch. I mean, I also heard like
baseball fun again.
I also heard like they're trying to take fights out of hockey. It's like, if you take fights out of hockey, people are probably going to stop watching hockey.
Well, that could be like our next topic of conversation.
I think fights in hockey are important to the nature of the sport.
I agree with you.
Like, no, I don't think that they should just fight. Like, that's a little ridiculous. But it's a really physical game, and you get in people's faces constantly. There's going to be conflict, and you know what? You gotta get it out.
Well, I think it's interesting is, like, the culture of the sport, too. So, like, you look at football, and that's a sport where you tackle each other, and you find far less confrontation and fighting in football than you do in hockey. And it's just, like... The culture, like, the hockey players don't care if the refs are there and, like, breaking them up. They will just fight the other person anyway.
Mm-hmm.
In the NFL,
as soon
for whatever
as the ref
reason,
steps in, it's...
Yeah, it's hands off. So, I don't know. It's just interesting with each sport.
Baseball
like
people used to charge
the
plate.
The little culture.
Yeah.
Charge the mound. Yeah, charging the...
Oh, yeah, charge the mound.
Yeah, I think it's another thing in hockey is that, you know, there are guys that are on teams... whose role is to fight someone who starts targeting their star player.
Yeah.
Like, it's part of the culture of the sport, the nature of the sport. It's like, if you take that away, people are just going to start targeting... Sidney Crosby won't make it another year. He'll be out all season. Like,
well, actually, that's a part of the game that's getting phased out right now, is you don't really have those goons anymore. You have to be good at hockey. You have players that can hit and that are tough, but you don't have guys on your team anymore that their sole purpose is fighting, which is, I guess that's a good thing if you want to see more skill.
So we're looking at enforcers rather than goons, huh? Is that what you're saying?
I mean, I'd rather have enforcers.
In hockey terms, enforcers are still considered goons. I would say, I'm trying to think of...
Defenders rather than enforcers?
Yeah, like, there's guys that are just tough as nails to play against, and they can drop the gloves when they have to, but they can still score goals, you know.
Yeah.
Andrew Peters played for the Buffalo Sabres. He was one of my bosses for my internship this summer.
Oh yeah.
The whole reason that I started getting into sports broadcasting was because of a hockey brawl. Like, I remember specifically watching that game, and I mentioned this in my internship presentation. I watched that game. I thought it was the greatest thing ever. The next morning, I flipped on the radio to listen to what the local sports guys had to say about it. And 10 years later, I'm doing an internship with the same guys that I listened to on the radio.
That presentation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So Andrew Peters, he scored like 4 goals in his career, and he played with the Sabres for like 6 or 7 years. It's, you know, so I'm just like, he was beloved for the team. Like, everyone loved him on the team and in the city, but. You can't have that kind of, you need to be able to roll 4 lines in today's game. And
I think that that's a big change in American sports in general, with just the skill level of every single player.
Yeah.
Because, you know, there used to be a day, like, some of the greatest pitchers of all time may not have even touched 90, because back then it was...
You saw 106. if you look at the records, you read those writings.
Like, but yeah, like, way back then, you know, some of those guys' swings, like, they were awful.
Yeah.
They just...
Evolution of sports.
Yeah. And now everything is so broke down and technical and skill-specific.
Yeah.
That... And America's just...
Well, you're afforded to now because of how much money is involved in
that
sports,
too.
So.
And even more so, we have a foreign exchange student who I was explaining, like, you know, how you have to think of, like, the different cultures in America as if every state is a country. Because we're huge. Like, Pennsylvania is the size of a country. It's bigger than most countries.
And
like,
the culture in Mississippi is not the same as the culture.
Exactly.
The culture in Western Pennsylvania
is
not
true.
The same as
from
the
Eastern
exactly.
Pennsylvania.
Exactly.
Pennsylvania.
So you got to think of, like, culture difference as being different everywhere. And then with sports, like, you could pull basically from 50 countries to make one sports team.
Yeah.
Like, that's unreal. That's why we're better than the rest of the world at so many sports, because we have so much, such a big talent pool to choose from.
I think another reason that the United States is good at sports is because of the role it has in society, though, too.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I mean, sports is so big in the United States that, like, everyone plays sports. It's uncommon for you to run into someone who has never played a sport in their entire life.
Well, I mean, it's great for kids.
No, absolutely. I'm not saying it's a bad thing to be active.
It's honestly, it's like the gladiators in Rome. Like, sure, most of them were like slaves, but people loved them.
Yeah.
Like, people crowded the Colosseum to watch them fight and cheered for them and loved them. And now we crowd stadiums every day to watch sporting events.
Yeah.
Like,
it's funny though, we love our sports. We love American sports. We don't dominate in everything. Even though you look at the population
mm-hmm.
size of the country, diversity of the country, it's like, we should be better at soccer.
I think it's a culture.
Well, that's also,
yeah.
I agree with you. I think it's, if the United States was as big on soccer as, say, a country like Germany or England.
Or Spain.
I absolutely mm-hmm. would say that the United States would probably be as good.
Would be an elite contender every year.
Every
yeah.
single World Cup.
But the guys that could be playing soccer, there are a whole bunch of other alternatives that they can go to. And
I assume you knew, like, Odell Beckham was considered like a soccer prodigy.
Really?
Did you know that? He was phenomenal soccer player. Like, he absolutely would have gone all the way in soccer. But it's not as much money.
and he's
made a fine career choice.
Yeah.
You know?
They just might think football is more fun. I just think it's interesting too. Like, I wonder what the culture is like in, like, Great Britain. Like, every Friday night in, like, every community in America, there's high school football.
Yeah.
In the fall.
What's it like?
Like, what do they do in England? Is there, like, high school soccer?
I'm sure.
Pretty sure they all go watch cricket.
Their school system is a lot different than ours, but I'm sure.
I'm not even sure if sports are part of a school per se.
That's really an American thing. Is that?
Yeah. No.
I agree.
It's more club.
I mean,
in youth sports.
I'm pretty sure, like, private schools over in Britain, they probably all go play lacrosse. Not lacrosse, but polo. Polo. They all ride horses and play polo.
That's something you have on your shirt over here.
Yeah, so I mean, that's another American thing, high school sports.
Yeah.
So
it's huge.
And you think about, like, colleges, like the big colleges, the revenue that football makes is outrageous.
And that pays for all the other sports.
All the other sports.
You know, like, I hate to use Blue Mountain State as an example, but there's the episode where Alex Moran goes, like, into, like, what the NCAA is doing and how much money they make off of, like, the major sporting, like, the major football teams and the major games.
Well, there's no better product on TV than live sports, and there's no other sport on TV than football. And outside of the NFL, like that's as good as you're going to get. And what college football has going for it as well is there are more teams, and, like, literally every Saturday afternoon into night, there's a great game on TV.
Yep.
Like, in those national spots on ABC, on ESPN, on whatever network, CBS. They just crush.
You know, talking about the culture, like, in the South, college football is much bigger than professional football.
Mm-hmm.
Like, the University of Florida and
even
Florida
high
State.
School football.
Yeah, like, Texas high school football.
High school football is your life.
Right.
Like, if you were the king of your high school football team, you are going to be the king of your town for the next 25 years.
Well, think about how big college football is in, like, the SEC conference. Like, for each individual
mm-hmm.
area. You know, Ole Miss,
LSU,
Georgia, Alabama, LSU, Florida. Like,
Auburn.
Yeah, that's Georgia. So, like, it's nuts. Is it Auburn, Alabama?
Yeah.
Auburn, Alabama, that's right.
And that's why the rivalry is so heated.
Yeah.
They're so close.
Yeah.
You're from Louisiana, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, New Orleans.
Really?
Very cool.
Wait, did you come here from New Orleans?
I came here from New Orleans. Not I came here, but I came up north from New Orleans. I moved in 2006 after Hurricane Katrina.
Really?
Really.
How old were you when that happened?
7.
Were you, like, a refugee, or...?
No, I technically, yes, but I lived at my grandparents'. Like, I lived in my aunt's house, because she had, like, a brick house. I had 6 feet of water flood my house. Mold, mildew, everything, had to completely gut the house.
No
way.
And
you just never went back to live there?
Never went back. I mean, I've been back to visit because I have, like, friends and family down there still, but I've never went back to actually live.
I've never heard that story about you.
Wow.
That's actually really interesting. Were you a Tiger fan?
I am an LSU Tiger fan. I have one that says home, and the back says the state of mind with Death Valley.
Very cool. I heard that experience is, like, one of the best game day experiences you could ever have.
It is beautiful. I love watching when they play Florida. I love watching. My favorite game to watch is when LSU plays Auburn. That's one of the games.
Auburn?
I will always watch the Tiger show off. And LSU have Alabama whenever they play. It's always a fun game.
Of course.
Especially this past year, holding them 0-0 into the final quarter.
Yeah. Crazy.
All right, well, we've been going for a pretty long time. So
How long are these usually?
About 30 minutes. And 30 minutes is still long for us, and I think we've gone well beyond that at this point. So
doesn't surprise me at all that having us two, we just talked about sports and
yep.
the comm department.
No, nothing wrong with sports
and
the comm department.
The whole time. That's
yeah.
that's where we are right now.
I mean, it's okay. It's number 10. It can be a little special. So.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You guys are special. We're just never asking you back because you talk too much.
what do you mean it's number 10? You said that you've done like 20 Bo Sauces.
Okay,
here.
So...
This is
what
number
up
10 for What Up.
Is a play on the new name of the channel. We're Waynesburg University Digital Productions. And when I said that to our advisor, Melinda Roeder, she laughed because the acronym is What Up. And so the name of the vodcast is capital WUD, lowercase p, U, capital P.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And last semester...
It's What Up.
Yeah. Last semester it was the WCTV Executive Vodcast. Because it was
what
the executive
staff. We're definitely
exactly.
not executives. Oh my goodness.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. Well, thank you two for joining us this week. And thank you for watching. We'll see you next week.